But another figure, now forgotten, who was making equally pioneering work, would prove to be the movement's missing link.
Around the same time that Rauschenberg started working on his combines, another young artist was forging a reputation in the city. He was gay, he was curiously sociable yet at the same time detached, and he was obsessed with celebrity and repetition. And already by the 1950s, he was incorporating into his art photographs of film stars as well as corporate logos. Now, his name wasn't Andy Warhol, but Ray Johnson, the greatest artist you've never heard of.
In the late 50s, Ray Johnson was a leading avant-garde artist who was just as well known as Rauschenberg and Johns. Yet when he died in 1995, he was a virtual recluse, his house filled with boxes of unseen work. They were discovered by his friend and dealer, Francis Beatty. And they're now stored here at the Richard Feigen Gallery. They contain proof that Johnson truly was one of pop art's pioneers.
This is one of the most amazing documents about early pop art and Ray Johnson. These are incredible collages. Look at the amount of them.
Look at this. I mean, here's Marlon Brando.
Right.
There's William Shakespeare. There's, right. This is a sort of, what's that, some sort of brand of Mexico something or other?
Right.
And that looks like another kind of brand name.
For Johnson, art was about the process, not the product. He considered his work a kind of performance art and destroyed almost all of his pop collages.
These are a group of iconic early works from 55, 56. Here you have James Dean, right? Iconic photograph of James Dean. And what does he do with it? He puts two lucky strikes and they look like mouse ears, right? It's a reference to the cigarette as well as to Mickey Mouse. So you have all of those things going on at the same time.
These are really quite extraordinary visual works of art in the sense of how early they are, because dealing with logos, brand names, dealing with iconic film stars, these are all the things that pop art would famously do, but much later.
Right.
And sure enough, a few years later, another artist would produce some icons of his own. Andy Warhol was a close friend of Ray Johnson. When they met in 1956, Warhol was one of New York's most successful commercial illustrators, but he was still yearning to be taken seriously as a fine artist. Their friendship would be mutually beneficial. Through Warhol, Johnson won commercial commissions. Through Johnson, Warhol met important avant-garde contacts. And he became increasingly familiar with Johnson's work.
Picasso said, good artists borrow, great artists steal.
But to follow through what you're saying, it's that Warhol was a genius, therefore he stole Ray Johnson's work.
I think that if Ray were around, he would not want to be judged by what Warhol took from him, but by what he did.
Sometimes I feel.
He may have created some of America's earliest pop art, but unlike Warhol, who lusted after fame, Johnson resisted the spotlight. In 1968, he was mugged at knife point. Traumatized, he fled to Long Island and became a recluse. His most famous artwork was his last. On Friday the 13th of January, 1995, Johnson dived off the Sag Harbor Bridge, dressed head to toe in black. Passers-by saw him backstroking into the horizon.
His death really was a death orchestrated like him.
So, do people really think that it was almost like a final performance?
Yeah, I think so. Because Richard Feigen went to his studio afterwards, and there was the only thing visible was a photograph of Ray going,
Johnson was a victim of the city that inspired his work, and his experience points to one of pop art's darkest and most prescient themes, how urban life, for all its neon pleasures, robs us not just of community, but also of our very soul. The daily grind of the city turns us all into grist.